गुड आफ्टरनून सर।
गुड आफ्टरनून
सर। गुड इवनिंग सर।
गुड इवनिंग अंड
A very pleasant evening to all. I am Yashaswini, corresponding secretary of AACSV's student chapter. I'd like to take the immense pleasure to extend a warm welcome to all the students and faculty of Civil Engineering Department, Sri Vidyaniketan Engineering College, on behalf of AACSV's student chapter. In our country, Engineers' Day is celebrated by engineering fraternity on 15 September every year in memory of legendary engineer Bharat Ratna Dr. Mokshagundam Vishwasaraya's birth anniversary. Which is why we have virtually gathered here. We are fortunate enough to have our beloved BOS chairman, head of the Civil Engineering Department, faculty advisor AACSV's student chapter, Dr. O. Ishwaradi sir, as the guest speaker of today's event. Now, my peer Manisha will take the opportunity to read the profile of Dr. O. Ishwaradi sir. Over to you, Manisha.
Thank you, Yashaswini. It's my pleasure to read the profile of Dr. O. Ishwaradi sir. Dr. O. Ishwaradi did his post-graduation M.Tech in Geotechnical Engineering for NIT Warangal, and he was awarded PhD in Civil Engineering by JNTU Hyderabad for his work on pull-out response of granular pile anchors. He has 20 years of teaching, research, consultancy, industrial and administrative experience. He worked as project engineer cum geotechnical engineer for various highway projects. He served at different academic capacities in various institutes of distinction. He has been working as professor and chairman board of studies in the Department of Civil Engineering at SVEC Tirupati since 2010. He serves as technical advisor for Entrix Engineering and Construction Private Limited, Chennai, and Nischint Quality in Construction, Bangalore. He has to his credit 32 publications in national and international conferences and journals. He got recognized as Geo-Environmental Expert, National Network of Experts and Resources for Subsurface Investigation and Remediation of Contaminated Sites, IIT Delhi, prepared for Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Government of India, July 2018. He is an executive committee member, Indian Geotechnical Society, IGS, Tirupati chapter. He is a reviewer and editorial board member of various national and international journals. He is a life fellow of IGS and IEI. He is a life member of IGS, ISRMTT, IRC, ISTE, ISCA, ISS, MGE and ASCE. Thank you. Now I request Dr. O. Ishwaradi sir to address the gathering.
Yeah, good evening everyone. So happy Engineers Day. So it is 53rd Engineers Day celebrations, and in commemoration with Bharat Ratna sir Mokshagundam Vishwasaraya. So on this happy occasion, so I would like to share my experiences, so as an engineer, with the student community. So I used to deliver lecture, I used to organize Engineers Day celebration every year since 2010, since the inception of the Civil Engineering Department. So it's our customary duty to remember the remarkable contributions made by Sir MV to the nation, and we need to follow him, follow his footprints. So in practicing civil engineering, imbibing all his qualities to the maximum extent within the given environment. So this is the objective of Engineers Day celebrations. So to get inspiration from Sir MB, autobiography, and his deeds and actions to the country. Thank you. Shall I go ahead with the lecture or?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead, sir.
Yeah. So happy Engineers Day, 53rd Engineers Day we are celebrating here. So this Engineers Day is celebrated in commemoration of 160th birth anniversary of Bharat Ratna Sir Mokshagundam Visveswaraya. So the Institution of Engineers India so identified the theme for this particular Engineers Day as Engineers for a Self-Reliant India. So you know pretty well what is Self-Reliant India. So the government of India is striving for Atmanirbhar Bharat. So that means that it has to be self-sustained, self-reliant, means every product has to be manufactured indigenously. So engineers should strive for this self-reliant India. That is the theme of 53rd Engineers Day. With this, it's my honor to present the autobiography of Sir M. Visveswaraya. So a legendary in the Indian history. I just touch upon various stages of his life and how he has contributed to the nation. So in all walks of life. So he's a great engineer, an efficient administrator, an eminent statesman, educationist, economist, social worker, and above all, a patriot of the highest order. That is Sir M. Visveswaraya. He was born in Muddanalli near Bangalore in the year 1861 on September 15th. And he demised at the age of 102 years on 14th April 1962. So he is a multifaceted personality contributing different sectors for the growth of the nation. Three distinguished facets are an eminent engineer, civil engineer, then an eminent statesman, then eminent economist. So 1884 to 1919, the distinguished engineer career, he pursued his career as an engineer. 1912 to 1960, he acted as statesman and economist. He contributed in these two fields. So some of the key persons spoke about him. So Dr. Brahmananda, Dr. Atre and other elite economists have expressed that Sir M.V. is one of the greatest economists India has seen. Then Pandit Nehru and Rajagopal Achari and other elite statesmen have expressed that Sir M.V. is one of the most eminent statesmen India has seen. The Indian engineering community feels that Sir M.V. is one of the most distinguished engineer India has seen. The public in general are convinced that Sir M.V. is a national icon and a patriot of highest integrity. In a sense, he is a multifaceted personality. So coming to the bibliography, the books that are there. So speeches by Sir M.V. Diwan of Mysore, the Government Press, Bangalore, 1917. M. Visveswaraya, Memoirs of My Working Life, Caxton Press, Bombay, 1951. Dildar Hussain, M.V. An Engineering Wizard of India, 1861 to 1962. Institution of Engineers, Hyderabad, 1966. Sitaramaya, M. Visveswaraya, Publications Division, Government of India, 1971. Atre, Dr. M. Visveswaraya, a Biography, Mysore Economic Review, Bangalore, 1983. Pandrinath Mokshagundam Vishveshwaraya National Book Trust 1988. Jayappa Gowda Diwan Sir M. Vishveshwaraya is achievements in Kannada. Shubhodaya Publishers 1994. B. Baswaraj Sir M. Vishveshwaraya's Words of Wisdom Sir M. V. Memorial Foundation Bangalore 2000. M. V. Iyengar Sir M. Vishveshwaraya A Centenary Compendium in Kannada. MVIJK Trust, Bangalore, 1960, again reprinted in 2002. Dilip Salvi, M. Vishveshwaraya, National Builder, Rupa and Co., New Delhi, 2003. Tribute, Bharat Ratna Sir MV, Vishveshwaraya National Memorial Trust, Bangalore, 2003. So coming to the education, Vishveshwaraya did his early education in Chakbalapur. Subsequently, in 1875, joined Wesley Mission High School at Bangalore. Continued studies in Central College in Bangalore, wherein he completed his BA in 1881 from Madras University, securing first class. Joined Science College in Pune, presently Government College of Engineering, to study engineering. Ranked first in LCE, awarded by this college in 1883. This is like BE of today. Was awarded James Berkeley Gold Medal for his outstanding performance. Then, what is the background to commencement of his career? What is the backdrop? It was by and large British rule in the country, with prominence for English officers and engineers. Poverty, illiteracy, lack of infrastructure, and bleak future was the common horizon in the country. Maharajas, Nijams, and other rulers of princely states by and large were interested more in self-survival and self-pleasures rather than welfare of common people. The country, in essence, was the most backward in the world scenario in all spheres. So this is the backdrop if we look at it in different locations of the country. Then about his family. In 1861, he was born as second son of Sri Srinivasa Sastri. In 75, sad demise of Srinivasa Sastri. 1882, he married to Miss Saraswati, daughter of Ramachandra Sastri of Chikbalapur. Then in 1888, sad demise of his wife with a newborn baby. 1889, second marriage with Savitri. 1890, sad demise of Miss Savitri along with newborn baby. 1891, third marriage with, separated from her soon after for reasons not clear. However, ensured to send money for her livelihood throughout his life till his death. Spent rest of his life alone. Then positions held. In 1884, he was appointed as assistant engineer in Public Works Department, Bombay Presidency, British government. Then 1899, appointed as executive engineer, Irrigation Department, Pune, Bombay Presidency, British government. Then 1909, appointed as special engineer, Hyderabad State. Then 1909, appointed chief engineer, Mysore State. In 1912, appointed as Diwan of Mysore, Mysore State. In 1919, retired from Diwanship of Mysore. So this is the published gazette. So you can read out this. So I will share this. Then this is the first assignment what he has done in 1884 as an engineer. His first assignment was in Khandes district, Dhulia, Bombay Presidency. As a part of water supply scheme to the Tathari village, he had to bring water through a siphon below the river Panjira. Siphon was essentially through rock. The British officer had set the time target. The work stalled frequently due to floods in Panjira. But the deadline had to be met. Even in heavy rains, he continued boring work by motivating staff and by working hard along with them. On more than one occasion, he had to take off his coat and swim across the river to assist his staff. The task was completed much before the set time target. So the takeaways from this is nothing but he has to swim across the river. He didn't feel shy to get into the water and swim to assist his staff members. The summary of some important works. So then one of the major contributions in Mysore state, that is presently in Karnataka, Krishnarajasagar Dam. So at Krishnarajasagar, so in 1909, then Vishveshwaraya Iron and Steel Works at Bhadravati, 1980, established University of Mysore in the year 1916, established College of Engineering at Bangalore, presently termed UVCE Bangalore, 1917. So established Sri Jayachamaraja Occupational Institute at Bangalore in 1929, constructed 205 miles of railway lines, initiated hydroelectric project to harness Jog Falls. Then coming to the water supply schemes in different parts of India, Ahmednagar, Maharashtra, Akkalkot, Maharashtra, Bangalore, Baroda, Belgaum, Bhavnagar, Gujarat, Bhopal, Bombay, Dharwad, Madgaon, Goa, Hyderabad, Indore, Kolhapur, Morbi, Nagpur, Nasik, Pune, Rajkot, Sangli, Surat. Then in Hyderabad state, schemes for flood protection and drainage for Hyderabad city, remodeling of Hyderabad city, advisory services during construction of Tungabhadra Dam. In Bihar and Orissa states, selection of site for railway bridge across River Ganga, advisory services for construction of a major dam across Mahanadi. Works outside India, EDEN, so water supply and drainage scheme. It is in Yemen, Sukkur barrage project, which is now in Pakistan. So in British rule, so Pakistan is in India only, undivided India. General works, introduced block system of irrigation in 1901, Neera canal irrigation system, then designed a new system of automatic flood sluice gates, Hadakwalsa dam at Pune in 1901. So these are the contributions as a civil engineer he has made to the nation. Then honors and titles awarded to him. In 1904, honorary membership of Institution of Engineers, London. In 1906, Kaiser A. Hind, in recognition of his services by British government. In 1911, CIE, Companion of Indian Empire by British government. In 1915, KCIE, Knight Commander of Indian Empire by British government. Then in 1955, Bharat Ratna, the highest distinction in the country, government of India. So this is the photograph showing Sir M.V. receiving Bharat Ratna Award at Rashtrapati Bhavan in New Delhi on September 7th, 1955. Then 1958, Durga Prasad Khaitan Memorial Gold Medal, the Royal Asiatic Society. 1959, Fellowship of the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Then honorary degrees awarded, DSC, Doctor of Science, University of Calcutta, 1921, Allahabad, 1944, Patna, 1944, Jadavpur University, 1958. Then LLD, University of Bombay, 1931, Mysore, 1948, D.Litt, University of Benares, 1937, Andhra University, 1953. A few of his engineering accomplishments, so I already discussed this, but one case study we will have, Sukkur Water Supply System, 1895. So water supply to the town, Sindh province, it is in Sindh province, was turbid and unfit for drinking. It was the cause of several illness affecting the town inhabitants. He decided that clean water must be supplied. Sukkur town authority was not financially sound enough to adopt filtration. Sir M.V. developed a new scheme. He dug a tube well on the bank of the river and struck underground water. It was essentially river water filtered by the intervening rock mass. Water was clean enough. Further, a tunnel was driven from the bottom of the well for some distance under the flowing river to augment the clean water. This technique today is termed as collector well system. So this is another work, Eden Water Works, 1906 in MN. One of the significant accomplishments of Sir M.V. was the project at Eden. This was in 1906. Eden was being administered by Bombay Presidency. So several hardships were being experienced by public at Eden due to paucity of drinking water and due to paucity of cleanliness in the city. The British government directed Government of India to look into this problem. So this is the MN. Presently it is an MN. So the city is in MN. So Sir M.V. studied the entire geography and identified that a reservoir of water existed at a considerable depth at a location about 18 miles away from the Eden city. Sir M.V.'s scheme comprised of providing deep bore wells at this location and pumping out clear water for drinking. The scheme successfully worked. Further, Sir M.V. designed surface and underground drainage schemes for this particular town. The city still remembers the great engineer who came to their rescue. The British government, in recognition of his services, awarded him the title Kaiser-e-Hind. Then KRS Dam in Mysore, 1909. So the project involved construction of a 130 feet high masonry dam capable of holding 48,000 million cubic feet of water. So it was intended to irrigate 150,000 acres of land and generate 80,000 horsepower, estimated to cost rupees 91 lakhs. Completed in 1931, the masonry dam today stands 134 feet high and 111 feet wide. Of its 161 sluice gates, 48 are automatic type, designed and patented by Sir M.V. So operating on power, the gates automatically close when water level is below 124 feet. When the level of lake rises above, the gates automatically rise, allowing excess water to flow out. In its construction, Surki motor was used instead of cement motor. Surki motor is nothing but lime with powder of brick vats, brick powder instead of sand. The project is termed first multi-purpose river valley project in India. So services to Hyderabad state. So soon after he retired from Bombay services in 1998, he took up an extensive tour abroad. During this period, due to very heavy rains, there were unprecedented floods in Musi River, devastating parts of Hyderabad. The havoc was essentially due to 12 inches of rain on a single day in the catchment area of Musi River. So this is the catchment area of Musi River. Sir M.V. was called by the Nizam of Hyderabad to come over immediately and to provide relief. He cut short his tour from abroad and returned on three conditions. The first condition is he should be given independent charge. He should be free to appoint his staff and his salary should be at par with the senior most English engineer. He could ascertain that the problem was not just by Musi River, but the twin rivers Musi, which flows through Hyderabad city, and Iyasi, so which flows at the periphery of the city. He investigated in depth the entire stretch of two rivers from birth to their points of merger, and he recommended two dams. The first across Musi at 8 miles from Hyderabad, and the second across Iyasi 6 miles away. Further, he recommended raising the bund of Musi on either side inside the city and beautification of the area. The construction of dams were taken in 1913. After retirement from Divanship of Mysore, he helped Hyderabad state completing successfully the projects. These are the well-known Himayat Sagar and Usman Sagar of Hyderabad city. He was re-invited by Nizam during 1922 and 1930 for improvement of Hyderabad city. So dam across Mahanadi, this is another contribution in 1937. Orissa's Mahanadi Delta was a land of floods causing misery year after year. In 1927-28, a committee of two engineers constituted the government and opined that it is next to impossible to control floods. In 1937, Orissa suffered heavily. Gandhiji visited the area to see firsthand the plight of people. He suggested to the chief engineer of Orissa province, Mr. Vishwanatha Das, to invite Visveshwaraya. So this is the catchment area and the floods. So then Sir MV visited the affected areas, examined several possibilities and studied the available facts and figures. The first possibility was to construct dams across three important tributaries of Mahanadi to regulate floods. Second possibility was to build a major dam across Mahanadi at higher reaches. He recommended the second alternative to control floods, to irrigate vast stretches and to generate power. Soon after independence, Hirakud was realized based on his recommendations, Hirakud Dam. So then the Ganga Bridge in Bihar in 1951. So the Bengal province suggested the bridge at Farakka or Rajmahal. The Assam province suggested Manihari location, whereas Bihar province stuck to Mukmeh. So this is the project area. So then in 1951, then Nehru government looked around for an eminent engineer, unbiased and beyond the pulls and pressures to look into this problem. Sir MV was invited for this task by the Nehru government. He was 92 years at that time. The old man examined the entire stretch of Ganga River from Patna to Farakka through boats, helicopter and railway. He held discussions with leading industrialists and with various chambers of commerce. Further, he held discussions with the Chief of Army, General Timmaiya, and studied statistical figures, economic viabilities. Finally, he recommended Mukmeh as the right place. In 1953, work commenced and was completed in 1959, costing about 15 crores. So then an interesting finding report in 1929. It was during the construction of Lloyd Barrage across Sindh River. That time it was a great project. The work was being carried out by British engineering concerns. During the construction, there was a hue and cry by the public that there was large scale misappropriation of funds and the quality of the construction was suspect. Further, there was inordinate delay in the construction. So this is the project site. The government of Bombay Presidency appointed two men commissioned to inquire about these deeds of the British concerns. The members were Sir MV and the then chief engineer from Hyderabad State Nawab, Ali Nawab Jang. For about 5 months, Sir MV studied a very little bit of details and reported that the quality of construction was satisfactory. There was no truth in the rumors that there is misappropriation of funds. The inordinate delay was due to the complexities in the project and improper planning. The project was originally underestimated and was not realistic. In essence, Sir MV's report cleared all concerned, including the then governor of Bombay Presidency and Viceroy of India. So then Bombay Back Bay Inquiry Committee. So like this, he has contributed without any biased decision. He has given the reports. This is another report. Then a technical mediation, arbitration he has done in 1947. So Tungabhadra Dam. Then he has patented automatic floodgates, as we discussed in 1903. So these are the design, how it works, the cross-sectional view and the schematic view. Then patent agreement for the sluice gates. You can see patent agreement during that time. Then foreign tours of Sir MV. He made extensive tours abroad, particularly to America and Europe and Japan. He undertook these tours to see the economic conditions of people in those countries, to collect data about industries, and to study civil engineering projects, especially irrigation projects. Nation was immensely benefited by his tours. So these are the different tours in 1898. So in 1898, he visited Japan. In 1908, he, during his tour, examined engineering developments in water supply, drainage, and general engineering works in Europe, America, and Canada. In 1919, so he made a tour to Japan, America, and Canada, and Britain, along with other colleagues. Then in 1926, America and Europe. In 1935, Europe and America, automobile industry. Then 1946, he led a delegation of members of Indian Manufacturers Association to Britain, America, and Canada. Visited textile industries, aircraft factories, and automobile units. The complete tour served the purpose of the visits. Sir MV in Britain, some of the rarest pictures. The middle person. Then contributions to industrial growth of India. So his slogan was industrialize or perish. His contributions were significant for industrial growth of the country, which at that time was most backward. The three that benefited by his efforts are steel manufacturing industry, automobile industry, and aircraft industry. So then the plant was the result of foreshifted vision of Sir MV. Then coal required for so these are the works at Bhadravati in 1980. So coal required for converting iron ore to iron on a large scale was not available nearby. So transporting coal from long distances was uneconomical. A scheme was prepared and implemented to transport ore from Baba Bundagiri Hills by a combination of ropeway and tramway. Charcoal instead of coal became the fuel medium for melting iron ore. So this is the first plant in Asia to undertake manufacture of pig iron using charcoal. So then it became first plant in India to export pig iron to East Coast districts of America. Became the first plant in India to generate power from waste gases. Then this is the first plant in India to utilize waste charcoal fines to produce calcium carbide. Subsequently, in 1925, cast iron pipes were manufactured with the help of a German firm. So coming to the manufacturing unit, 1942, Sir MV was keen in establishing a manufacturing unit in India. Through his foreign tours, he established a rapport with leading manufacturers around the world, such as General Motors Corporation and others. His negotiations with the Chrysler Company for establishing the unit in Mysore fell through due to ban on new manufacturing units in Chrysler states by the British government. So, undeterred, he convinced his friends V.D. Thakkarse, R. Kaitan, and M. Kathau and Walchand Hirachand to establish a unit at least in Bombay Presidency. So eventually Walchand Hirachand got interested, and Premier Automobile Company. So the first plant in India was established on the outskirts of Bombay in 1942. This was followed by establishment of Hindustan Aircrafts at Bangalore in 1946 by Walchand Hirachand. then political arena, so the role of Sir MV. He took part in two political conferences in 1922 and in 1929. So the one is in the Bombay All Party Political Conference. The second one is the South India States People's Conference. Okay. So then the Secretary of State for India, Lord Montague, offered Sir MV a seat in his council at London. This was politely declined by Sir MV. Sir MV never entered political arena thereafter. So then chairmanships and memberships of different societies and professional bodies. So 1921 chairman, Bombay Tech and Industrial Education Committee. Then 1922 member, New Capital Inquiry Committee of Government of India. 1923 to 29 chairman of Board of Management, Bhadravati Iron and Steel Works. 1925 chairman, Indian Economic Inquiry Committee. Then member, Karachi Municipal Finance Administration Committee in 1926. Director, Board of Directors, Tata Iron and Steel Company in 1927 and 55. Then 1929 member, Bangalore Political Disturbances Inquiry Committee. So chairman, Bombay University Committee for Promoting Chemical Industry in 1930. In 1937, he became chairman committee on irrigation policy by Bombay Presidency Government. He acted as chairman court of the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore in 1937 to 47. So from 1941 to 54, President All India Manufacturers Association. So then a few sayings of Sir MV. So quotes, if your business is only to sweep a crossing, remember it is your duty to make that crossing the best swept in the world. Success in life depends on action, on what you do, and not on what you feel or think. The price of success is hard work. It is better to serve like steel than rust and wither away like iron. Take care of the pieces well, the whole will take care of itself. Nature never excuses lapses. Courage, conviction, and confidence should be the hallmarks. Dare to do right, fear to do wrong. Never try to appear what you are not. Sacrifice money rather than principles. Don't reckon on chances, but work hard. And many others he has quoted. So books authored by Sir MV. So these are the books authored by Sir MV. Reconstructing India in 1920. Unemployment in India, its causes and cure in 1932. Planned economy for India in 1934. Nation building, a five-year plan for the provinces in 1937. District development scheme, economic progress by forced marches in 1939. Prosperity through industry in 1943, Memoirs of My Working Life in 1951, about the great man, so by different key persons in Indian history. Sri Vishveshwaraya is a man of incorruptible integrity and a model of purity of character. His simplicity and essence of correct behavior are extraordinary, rising sometimes to an unbelievable degree, a pure soul and a great heart and a passionately patriotic citizen of India by Dr. C. Rajagopal Achari in 1960. The Chief of Bureau, The Hindu, September 2003, in Vishveshwaraya Memorial Trust publication under the theme Tribute. Sir M. Vishveshwaraya was perhaps the first technocrat to become a national icon. What the Narayana Murthys and the Premjis of the IT world are talking today, Sir M. V. had dinned in the years of then previous leaders, Indian and British. Needless to say, Sir MV would have ushered in the IT era had the technology been developed in his time. His perceptions of modern technology, his emphasis on merit in every walk of life, the highest form of integrity, shunning nepotism and favoritism, efficiency in administration, and observance of discipline in life are more relevant today than any time before. So this is a rare picture in 1955. So this is Sarvepalli Radhakrishna with Nehru, Pandit Nehru in 1960. So this is Sarojini Naidu. So in 1960. In conclusion, so Sir MV is indeed a legendary figure in the Indian history. His creativity was not confined to just his professional discipline. His thoughts and innovations were far ahead of his time. His thoughts and actions were always out of his concern for the masses. He was the embodiment of discipline and hard work. This is, in brief, a glimpse of the legendary figure, the great engineer, an eminent statesman, an economist for excellence, and above all, a patriot of the highest order. So, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for sharing your words of wisdom and the greatness of the world's preeminent engineer, Bharat Ratna, Sir Dr. Mokshagundam Vishweshwaraya, in an inspiring way. Now, Manoj Kumar, President of ACSV Student Chapter, will deliver a note of thanks. Over to you, Manoj.
1 minute, Manoj.
Thank you, Ashwini. Okay, sir. Okay, yes,
sir. I will share one of the videos.
Industrialization was the only cure for some of the ills of our rural economy.
Yeah.
He prepared a scheme for rural industrialization, which the Mysore government accepted and implemented. Over the years, he gave practical schemes or advice for the water supply of many towns in India. He was also responsible for the water supply schemes of Goa, Hyderabad, Sindh, and Aden. Vishweshwaraya worked incessantly, preparing plans and schemes for the development of the country. He published several books and pamphlets. Waking or sleeping, he had only one thought in his mind, nation building. Vishweshwaraya traveled abroad several times. Wherever he went, his one consuming desire was to bring back technical know-how for the development of his own motherland. Gave his invaluable technical advice for the location of one of the colossal projects of recent times, the Ganga Bridge at Mokame in Bihar. He was past 90 when he undertook this work. His deep interest in the industrialization of the country led Vishweshwaraya to found the All India Manufacturers Organization in 1941. Its motto, Prosperity Through Industry. He wanted manufacturers in the country to develop initiative and build new industries with the help of modern methods of organization. As the founder president of the organization, Vishweshwaraya still keeps in close touch with its activities and gives the organization the benefit of his rich experience and wise counsel. A grateful nation has heaped honors on a man who has served the country in so many spheres. knighthood, degrees, honoris causa galore. When the centenary of his alma mater, the Central College in Bangalore, was celebrated, he was honored as the oldest and the greatest living alumnus. The highest honor that an Indian citizen could receive, the award of Bharat Ratna, came to him. In the citation, he was hailed as the father of the idea of planned development in India. But all these honors sit lightly on Vishveshwaraya's shoulders. Unaffected by all these, he lives today in his Bangalore home without a trace of ostentation. His devoted old secretary still assists him in all his work. Meticulously punctual in his habits, Vishveshwaraya keeps himself busy and active, receiving visitors, holding discussions with them, attending social functions. For he thinks with Ulysses, how dull it is to pause, to make an end, to rust unburnished, not to shine in use, as though to breathe were life. The one motto of Vishveshwaraya throughout his life has been, work is worship. As this Karma Yogi enters his 100th year, we cannot do better than invoke the benedictions of our sages of yore. May we for 100 autumns see that lustrous eye, God ordained, arise before us. May we live 100 autumns. May we hear for 100 autumns. May we speak well for 100 autumns. May we hold our head high for 100 autumns. Yea, even beyond 100 autumns.
Yeah, so you would have seen his life history. He is the role model for any engineer, for that matter, is concerned. So we need to imbibe his qualities to the maximum extent, if not 100%. So to the maximum extent in anybody's life. So I expect all my students and colleagues so to practice the professional practice by imbibing so at least some of his qualities, so that we will give a right direction to our students as well as the followers, those who are following us in day-to-day life. Thank you very much for this opportunity. So hand over session to AC.
Manoj.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for sharing your wisdom, words of wisdom, sir.
Now, thank you, Manoj.
So, as we have to come to close this event, it is my pleasure to deliver a vote of thanks on behalf of our team to all who have helped to make this event a magnificent success. And I wish to thank the guest speaker, Dr. O. Ishwar Reddy, sir, faculty advisor of AAC SVEC student chapter and also principal of SVEC, and our management. I would like to thank the coordinator of AAC, office bearers of AAC SVEC student chapter, faculty and students of civil engineering. Once again, I'm thanking everyone for participating in this event and help to make this event successful. Once again, happy Engineers Day and Jai Hind.
Thank you.
Thank you, colleagues, everybody, students. So now onwards, please try to attend each and every event. So you know pretty well about the importance of Engineers Day. Okay, this and all these events are to inspire you. You need to get inspiration. So whatever we have presented here, so it should inspire you. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye, Purushottam.
Okay, bye.
I appreciate the efforts of AACE team. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.